गुड मॉर्निंग। टुडे विल डिस्कस अबाउट द किडनीज एंड सुप्रारीनल ग्लैंड। इंट्रोडक्शन। किडनी इट इज एन एसेंशियल एक्सिलेटरी ऑर्गन। फंक्शंस इज इट इलेबरेट द यूरिन, एलिमिनेट नाइट्रोजिनस वेस्ट प्रोडक्ट्स ऑफ प्रोटीन मेटाबॉलिज्म, मेंटेन वाटर एंड इलेक्ट्रोलाइट बैलेंस ऑफ आवर बॉडी, रेनिन ऑटो रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड फ्लो एंड ब्लड प्रेशर। सो दीज आर द मेन फंक्शंस ऑफ आवर किडनी। Location, kidney, it is a retroperitoneal organ, lies in a posterior abdominal wall by the sides of vertebral column. It lies in lumbar region, umbilical region, epigastric and hypochondric region. It extends from the 12th thoracic vertebrae to the 3rd lumbar vertebrae. Axis, long axis of kidney, it goes downward and laterally. Upper end nearer to the vertebral column than the lower end. Transverse axis goes laterally and backward because it is rest on the sloping paravertebral gutter of muscles. Pyloric plane, the right kidney, it passes from the upper part of hilum, while in left kidney the pyloric plane passes from the lower part of the hilum. Now the size and shape of a kidney. It is 11 cm in length, 6 cm width, and the thickness is 3 cm. Weight in adult male it is about 150 to 170 grams and in adult female it is about 130 to 150 grams. Kidney is bean shaped with hilum medially. The left kidney is longer, narrower and nearer to the vertebral column than the right kidney. The factors that keep the kidney in positions are the pressure of nearby viscera. This is maintaining by the tone of abdominal muscles. Second factor, by disposition of renal fascia and distribution of renal fat. Third, pedicles of kidney. It includes renal vessels and pelvis of ureter that attach to the hilum. Perirenal fascia. Perirenal fascia, sometimes referred to as gerotas fascia, is a dense elastic connective tissue sheath that envelops each kidney and suprarenal gland together with a layer of surrounding perirenal fat. The kidney and its vessels are embedded in perirenal fat, which is the thickest at renal borders and extend into the renal sinus at the hilum. This perirenal fascia was originally described as it is made up of two separate layers. The anterior layer of this perirenal fascia, it was known as fascia of Gerota, and the posterior layer of this perirenal fascia, it was known as fascia of Zuckerkindel. Both these fascia fused laterally to form the lateral conal fascia, and this lateral conal fascia continue anterolaterally behind the colon and it fuses with the parietal peritoneum. But some recent researches say that this perirenal fascia is not made up of fused fascia, but it is a single multi-laminated structure which is fused posteromedially with muscular fascia of Schwann's major and quadratus lumborum muscle. The fascia then extend laterally behind the kidney as a bilaminated sheath, and it is divided at a variable point into a thin layer which goes around the front of kidney as a anterior perirenal fascia, and a thicker posterior layer which continues anterolaterally as a lateral conal fascia or the posterior perirenal fascia. The previous view said that the above the suprarenal gland, the anterior and this posterior perirenal fascia are fused with each other and then get fused to the diaphragmatic fascia. But this research that done recently, it is said that the superior aspect of perirenal space is open and is in continuity to the bare area of liver on the right side, and with the subphrenic extraperitoneal space on the left side. So, according to this recent research, on the right side at the level of upper pole of kidney, the anterior fascia blend with the inferior coronary layer and bare area of liver, while on the left side the anterior layer fuses with the gastrocnemic ligament. Medially, the anterior layer is continuous with the other kidney and the posterior layer is attached either side of the vertebrae. Below, both the layers extend along the ureter and fuse with the iliac fascia. Posterior layer on both right and left side fuses with the fascia of muscles of psoas major and quadratus lumborum, as well as with the fascia on the inferior aspect of thoracoabdominal diaphragm. External features of kidney. Kidney has two poles, two borders and two surfaces. First we discuss the poles. Kidney has upper pole and lower pole. The upper pole, it is thicker and more rounded than the lower pole, and it is situated about 2.5 cm from the median plane at opposite to the T12 vertebrae. Lower pole, it is pointed, it goes downward and laterally, and it is 7.5 cm from the median plane at the level of L3 vertebrae. Now, borders, two borders, lateral border and medial border. The lateral border, it is convex, thick, and it is on more posterior plane than the medial border. Medial border, it is convex in upper and lower part, while in middle it has a one concavity. So this concavity, it is hilum. Now the hilum, it is situated 5 cm from the middle line opposite to the lower border of L1 vertebrae. This hilum, it has two lips, anterior lip and posterior lip. The anterior lip presents the two notches and the posterior lips has a one notch. Now structure passes through the hilum. Before backward, renal vein, renal artery and pelvis of ureter. Surfaces, the kidney has two surfaces, anterior surface and the posterior surface. Surfaces of kidney. Kidney has two surfaces, anterior surface and posterior surface. Anterior surface of a kidney, it is convex and irregular. It directed forward and laterally, and it is partially covered with the peritoneum. The relation of anterior surface on both the kidneys, right kidney and left kidney, are different. So first we discuss the relation of a right kidney. First, suprarenal area. It is non-peritoneal, includes upper pole and the upper part of medial border of kidney, which is overlapped by the right suprarenal gland. Second, duodenal area. It is non-peritoneal, passes along the medial border in front of the hilum and related with the second part of duodenum. Hepatic area, it is peritoneal, upper 3/4 of the anterior surface, related to the right lobe of liver, and it is separated by the hepatorenal pouch of Morrison. Colic area, it is non-peritoneal, occupies lateral part of the lower pole and related to the right colic flexure. Jejunal area, it is peritoneal, occupies middle part of lower pole and it is related with coils of jejunum. Now the relation on the anterior surface of left kidney, suprarenal area. It is non-peritoneal, occupies upper part of medial border and the upper pole of kidney, and it is overlapped by the left suprarenal gland. Splenic area, it is peritoneal, occupies 2/3 of lateral border and anterior surface, related with renal impression of spleen. Gastric area, it is peritoneal, present in between suprarenal and splenic area, and it is related to the posterior inferior surface of stomach. The linorenal ligament is attached along the junction of this gastric and splenic area. Pancreatic area, it is non-peritoneal, across the hilum of kidney, and it is related to the body of pancreas and splenic vessels. Colic area, it is non-peritoneal, occupies lower part of lateral border, and it is related to the left colic flexure and descending colon. Jejunal area, it lies on the last peritoneal area in front of medial part of lower pole, and it is related with coils of jejuna. Posterior surface of kidney, posterior surface, it is flat and it is non-peritoneal. It goes backward and medially. We can divide the posterior surface into two half for the relation upper part of a posterior surface and a lower part of a posterior surface. So first we see the upper part, posterior surface of a kidney. From the upper part, the diaphragm that arising from the medial and lateral arpate ligament, costodiaphragmatic recess of the corresponding pleura, 11th and 12th ribs only on the left side, while on the right side 12th rib only. In the lower part, three muscles are related on the posterior surface, lower part of our kidney. They are medial to lateral. First, medial most, that is Schwass major muscle. This Schwass major muscle is covered with the iliopsoas fascia. Lateral to it, quadratus lumborum muscle, that covered by the anterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. And the lateral most muscle on the posterior surface, lower half, it is transverse abdominis muscle, which is covered by fascia transversalis. Now in the lower part, posterior surface, some of the structures are related, so they are above downward. Subcostal vessels and nerve, below it, iliohypogastric nerve, below to it, ilioinguinal nerve, and fourth lumbar artery, that is only present on the right side. So these are the structures related with the kidney on a posterior surface. Renal angle, it is an angulation between the lower border of 12th rib and the lateral border of erector spinae muscle. This renal angle, it overlies the lower part of the kidney. The clinical importance of this renal angle is when we applying the pressure over this angle with the thumb, tenderness in the kidney is alleviated. So this is the clinical importance of renal angle. Macroscopic features of kidney. On the coronal section, the kidney shows outer reddish brown cortex, inner pale medulla, and a space that is renal sinus. First, renal medulla. Renal medulla, it is made up of about 10 conical masses. These conical masses are known as renal pyramids. These renal pyramids are striated and pale. Each renal pyramid has base and apex. The base of renal pyramids, it goes towards the cortex and apex, which projects into the wall of renal sinus. So this apex of renal pyramid, which projects into the wall of renal sinus, it is known as renal papilla. Each renal papilla, it is perforated by 16 to 20 ducts of Bellini, and this renal papilla is received by minor calyx. Now we said that the pyramids are striated. So the striations of pyramid are caused by the following factors. It is because of the series of U-shaped loop of Henle, collecting tubules and ducts of Bellini, arterioli retracti and the veni retracti. Now renal cortex. Renal cortex is divisible into two parts, cortical arches and the renal columns. So renal columns extend to the renal sinus between the adjacent pyramids. In other words, renal columns goes deep in between the two adjacent pyramids. Cortical arches, it is also known as cortical lobules, which form the caps over the base of pyramids. Cortical arches lies in between the base of the pyramid and the surface of kidney. Now, medullary ray. So, this medullary ray, it is striated conical mass. The apex of ray is directed to the surface of kidney, and the base, it continues with the striation of the pyramid. Now, what is lobe of kidney? So, each pyramid along with the overlying cortical arch, it forms a lobe of kidney. It means the one pyramid capped with the adjoining cortex is known as lobe of kidney. Now renal sinus. Renal sinus, it is a space that extends into the kidney from the hilum. It consists of branches of renal artery, tributaries of renal vein and renal pelvis. Now this renal pelvis, it is divided into 2 to 3 major calyx, and this major calyx are again divided into 7 to 13 minor calyces, and this each minor calyces ends in an expansion which is indented by 1 to 3 renal papillae. So this is the macroscopic feature of kidney. Arterial supply of kidney. Each kidney is supplied by a renal artery. This renal artery, it is a branch of abdominal aorta. Right renal artery, it is longer than the left renal artery because the abdominal aorta lies on the left side of a vertebral column. Sometimes there is an accessory renal artery is present. If this accessory renal artery is present, then it is arising from the aorta, and this accessory renal artery supplies the upper pole of a kidney or the lower pole of a kidney. It reaches the pole of kidney without passing through the hilum. Now the distribution of renal artery. Renal artery reaches the hilum of a kidney. It lies in between the renal vein anteriorly and the pelvis of ureter posteriorly. Then it divides into anterior division and the posterior division. This anterior division passes in front of the renal pelvis and subdivided into four segmental arteries: apical, upper, middle and lower. While the posterior division passes behind the renal pelvis and it is continued as a posterior segmental artery. Now these segmental arteries supplies the content of the renal sinuses and it divides into lobar branches. This lobar artery divides into two interlobar artery. This interlobar artery pass through the renal columns between the adjacent pyramids. At the junction of cortex and medulla, the interlobar artery divides into arcuate arteries, which runs over the base of a pyramid. The important thing is the arcuate arteries do not anastomose with one another. From this arcuate arteries, number of interlobular arteries arises. This interlobular arteries extends outwards through the cortex by the sides of medullary rays. The terminal branches of interlobular arteries spread beneath the capsule and it is form a subcapsular plexus. Each interlobular arteries gives origin from the sides to a number of efferent glomerular arterioles. This efferent arterioles from the glomerular plexus, which are received by the Bowman's capsule of cortical glomeruli. From this plexus, efferent arterioles arises. This efferent arterioles from the superficial zone of cortical glomeruli break up into the peritubular plexus. Blood from the plexus empties into the interlobular veins and finally drains into the arcuate vein, from there into the interlobar vein, lobar vein and then in a renal veins. So this system of circulation, it is known as major arterial circle. Now Gödel's line. So it is the junction between the area that supplied by the anterior and posterior divisions of the renal artery is known as Gödel's line. It is present on the posterior aspect of the kidney at the junction of medial 2/3 and lateral 1/3. Clinically, this Gödel's line, it is important. It is the functional avascular plane between the posterior segment medially and the upper and middle segment laterally. So it is suitable site for surgical incision to remove the renal stones in nephrolithotomy. Now supply of kidney. The sympathetic fibers are derived from the renal plexuses. The preganglionic fibers that take origin from the T10 to L1 spinal cord segments. this one is responsible for the location of referred pain in renal colic from low into infra umbilical part of the anterior abdominal wall, including the groin, along the distribution of mentioned before spinal nerves. The sympathetics are primarily vasomotor. They also supplies the juxtaglomerular cells. The parasympathetics are derived from the vagus nerves. Now, clinical anatomy of a kidney. First, we discuss the developmental anomalies of a kidney. Developmental anomalies, we can classify it according to its number, position, according to the shape, size of a kidney. So first, according to the number, agenesis of one kidney. It occurs when the ureteric bud fails to develop. Unilateral agenesis is more common. Before surgical operation of a kidney, one should investigate whether the other kidney is present and it is normally functioning or not. Multiple kidney, more than one kidney may be present. It may be on one side or both the sides. Reason, because of the early splitting of a ureteric bud. According to the position, pelvic kidney. This is because of when the kidney fails to ascend. Most common cause, sickle shaped fold of peritoneum, which projects from lateral pelvic wall. Fused kidney, sometimes one kidney may be displaced from its own side and fuses with the other kidney on the opposite side, but the ureter run to its respective side. According to the size, lobulated kidney may be in adult life and assumes a larger size than the normal kidney. According to the shape, horseshoe-shaped kidney. Sometimes the lower pole of both the kidneys are fused with each other by an isthmus. Aorta and inferior vena cava lies behind the isthmus, but the ureter passes usually in front of the isthmus. The horseshoe kidney lies at a lower level than the normal kidney because the ascent of kidney is arrested by the inferior mesenteric artery. This kidney, when both the kidneys are fused entirely across the middle line, but the ureter descends to respective side. A centrally placed hilum lies on the posterior surface of the kidney. So these are some developmental anomalies. Floating kidney. Floating kidney is a condition in which the kidneys are suspended from the posterior abdominal wall by a fold of peritoneum. In this condition, the upper pole of a kidney may be tilted downward, that producing the twisting of a renal blood vessels and the pelvis of ureter. So it leads to the anuria and severe pain in the loin. So this phenomena, it is known as Dilts crisis. Another condition, that is polycystic kidney. In polycystic kidney, the continuity between the nephrons and the connective tubules are not established. So the glomeruli continue to excrete the urine, which accumulate into the tubules due to the lack of outlet. It results tubules go under cystic enlargement and this leads to the polycystic kidney. Accessory renal arteries we have already discussed. Single kidney with two ureters. So in such a condition, both these ureters are open into the bladder either by a single orifice or by a separate orifice. If both the ureters open into the bladder by a separate orifice, then the lower ureter that drain the urine from the upper part of a kidney and the upper ureter drain
the urine from a lower part of a kidney. Now, renal calculi, it is also known as ureteric calculi. Incidence are more common in male than the female. The stones are formed by the aggregation of calcium, phosphate, oxalate. When urine becomes saturated with these salts, the small variation in pH causes this salt to precipitate and form the stones. The common site for the location of a stone like renal calyces, ureter, urinary bladder, etc. Renal colic, it is because of the stone in kidney or ureter. There may be a sudden pain which is felt in groin and often radiate downwards and forward into the groin. The pain is dull in nature and it is very severe spasmodic pain. The renal pain occurs due to the stretching of renal capsule or due to the spasm of smooth muscle in a renal pelvis. How it radiates, that we already seen in nervous innervation. Renal trauma, as the kidneys are well protected by the lower ribs, lumbar muscles and the vertebral columns. But sometimes some penetrating injuries like stab injuries, gunshot wounds or severe blunt injuries may crush the kidneys against the 11th or the 12th ribs. Blood from the ruptured kidney or the pus in a perirenal abscess. First it distends the renal fascia, then trickles downward within the fascia and may reach up to the pelvis. Transplantation of kidney. Indication, patient with end-stage renal failure diseases. The donor kidney is replaced retroperitoneally in the iliac fossa with the hilum parallel to the external iliac vessels. The renal artery of a donor kidney is anastomosed end-to-end to the internal iliac artery of a recipient. Lithotripsy. Large stones that located in the renal calyces may be fragmented into the smaller pieces by the application of shock wave therapy. So this method, it is known as lithotripsy. Advantage, we can avoid the major surgery like nephrolithotomy. So these are the some important clinical regarding the kidneys.